أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على النبي أبدا سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري وحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربي لا تؤاخذني مما يقولون واغفر لي ما لا يعلمون واجعلني خيرا مما يظنون أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Welcome to the House of Dua and welcome to the continuing conversation on the issue, the right way to worship, the issue from which we have been bringing you lessons about zakah, the third pillar of Islam. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I hope you have been following the discussion and I hope you are getting more and more enlightened about zakah and how to discharge this very vital principle of Islam. My dear brothers in Islam, in today's presentation, we are coming to you with another segment of the discussion. And today we are focusing on zakat recipients. My dear brothers in Islam, the discharge of the duty of zakah involves two aspects, the giver and the receiver. The receiver is known as the recipient. And both of them have a role to play in the discharge of this very important duty. As we have already mentioned to you, zakah is the third principle of Islam, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires those of us who believe in Him and worship Him alone to discharge. It's a financial responsibility imposed upon us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order to discharge this principle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands that those of us who are sufficiently endowed, and we have what is necessary for us to meet our basic needs. And beyond that, we have some level of income, depending on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established as the baseline. Then you are required to give out a little portion of your income to those who do not have. We have already explained the conditions of those who do not have. It's important for us to understand that in the society we live, there are some who have better than others. There is always somebody who have more than you. And of course, there is somebody below you. So when you are called upon to pay zakah, remember you are not being asked to do something that is against yourself. It's something that is going to be of benefit, for you. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate receiver of the zakah. That's why in Surah At-Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alam ya'lamu anna la yaqbalu tawba'an ibadihi wa ya'khudhu sadaqat. Don't they know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one, who accepts repentance from his slaves. And at the same time, he is the one who accepts their sadaqah, their zakah. And Deborah says, Islam, it's important for us, therefore, to be ready to discharge this responsibility. Before we go into the discussion, I want to advise you, just as I advise myself, never to intend to evade zakah. As we have already explained, this is a principle of Islam that has direct impact on your life as we live right now. It could make or unmake you. If you discharge this principle, you are definitely going to receive positive results in your life, even in the life of this dunya. And when we get to Akhirah, of course, you will have a better life. Therefore, let's try as much as possible to aspire towards discharging the principle of zakah, the same way we aspire to going to the masjid to worship, to do salat, the same way we aspire to do hajj, the same way we aspire to fast in the month of Ramadan, and the same way we make effort to protect our kalma shahada. Zakah is no exception. It is a responsibility in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires those who have enough or more than enough to give to those who do not have enough to meet their own needs. According to the hadith narrated by Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, you know, advised him as he was sending him out to go and discharge some responsibilities, including collection of zakah. And he told Mu'adh, "Ya Mu'adh, take zakah from those who are rich and give to those who are poor." My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that is the ultimate goal of zakah. But who are the people who are actually entitled to receive zakah? This is defined in Surah At-Tawbah, chapter 9 of the Holy Quran, verse 60, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared, "Bada'uzu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Innama sadaqatun lil fuqara'i wal masakin wal 'amilina 'alayha wal mu'allafati qulubuhum wa fi rikabi wal gharimin wa fi sabilillahi wa buni sabil faridatan min Allah wallahu 'alimun hakim." My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has listed 8 categories of people who are entitled to receive zakah. Number 1, the poor, those who do not have enough to meet their basic needs. And then number 2, the needy, those who do not have at all except that somebody else gives to them. Those are the needy. And of course, those who are in charge of the distribution of zakah, the collection and distribution of zakah. People who work in that categories are entitled to be paid their wages from the zakah. So also are those whose hearts need to be reconciled. These are people who have just entered Islam. They are at the borderline. Because they have just entered Islam, either their previous friends and their relations have abandoned them, they have nobody to support them, and they are just into a new community in which they don't know nobody. Therefore, such people need to be supported to strengthen their heart as Muslims. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the next category are those who fear rikab, those who are in bondage or in prison, especially those who used to be slaves in those days. Today, those who are in bondage are expected to receive zakah, if that will help to get them freedom, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants freedom for everybody in the society. Same thing are those who are overwhelmed by their level of indebtedness, to the extent that what they owe to other people is more than what they have to take care of themselves. Those are the garimin. Then, what about those who go out of their home to struggle or fight to defend Islam? Such people are entitled to be supported from zakah. Wabune sabid. So also are those who are stranded. They may be rich in their places of birth or domicile, but they travel out of their places of residence and they got themselves either robbed or lost their belongings and they got stranded. Such people are entitled to zakah, provided they are on a journey that is halal, legitimate. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, these are the categories of people that Allah says, these are the obligations from Allah. These are the commandments from Allah. These are the ones Allah says are by right entitled to receive zakah. Wallahu alimun hakim. Allah is all knowing and all wise. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the categories of people who are entitled to zakah are so straightforward to be understood. But before we go into that, what are they supposed to receive? As I stated in the previous presentation, we as people who are qualified to give zakah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so generous that the principle of zakah, like every other principle of Islam, is so simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to burden us with any responsibility beyond our capacity. He says, "La yukalifu lahu nafsan illa wus'aha." Allah will not place a burden on any soul beyond the soul's capacity. In another surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "La yukalifu lahu nafsan illa ma ataha." We will not place any burden on a soul beyond what has been provided for that soul. Your wealth is provided for you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why Allah knows the amount of it you need to give out in order for you not to suffer. He already knows. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, do not therefore think that your giving out zakah we subject you to, you know, deprivation or to suffering. No. That is what the prophet says. You know, giving out zakah or giving out sadaka does not decrease your wealth. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us be ready to pay zakah as and when due. But to evade zakah is a very serious, you know, sin in Islam. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not waste time in issuing commandments, reminding those who evade zakah that they surely will be punished. Wala ta sabana lazi na yabukalu na bima ta hun la hun mi fali huwa khairan lahun ba huwa sharun lahun sayuta waku na ma bekilu ya mal kiyama. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says those who think that, you know, they could be stingy, they will not give out their zakah, that will help them, they should not think so, it's not going to help them. As a matter of fact, it's worse for them to do so. What they are hoarding, what they are selfish with, will be, you know, exposed on the day of Qiyamah and be placed on their neck as a burden. It will be a problem for them on the day of accountability. Even here, it will be a problem for them. Problem after problem, you find yourself spending money on difficulties instead of spending money on things that will be of benefit to you. May Allah not put us in that situation. In another surah, Surah At-Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالَّذِينَ يَكْنِزُونَ الذَّهَبَ وَالْفِضَّةَ وَلَا يُنْفِقُونَهَا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَبَشِّرْهُم بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. Those who hoard their wealth in gold and silver, that is, their wealth in precious metals and in currency, or whatever form of wealth, provided it's zakatable wealth, those who refuse to discharge that responsibility, Allah told the Prophet, give them the news of a bad end on the day of accountability. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to allow us to experience that. My dear brothers in Islam, we are required to take out just a tiny portion of our income and give to those who do not have, who are disadvantaged in the society. And that portion we are required to give us is 2.5% of our income, our net income for the year. 2.5% of that net income is what we are expected to take out. A very tiny percentage. Compare that to the taxes that governments all across the world are charging their citizens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so merciful towards us that He doesn't want to overburden us. Look at Salat, for example. He says, worship 5 times a day. Each of the salawat in a day does not take more than 10 minutes. 10 times 5, you are looking at about 50 minutes. 50 minutes, not even up to an hour. Out of the 24 hours of one day that Allah gives to us, He says, spend 50 minutes with me, minimum. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, what about zakah? Again, 2.5% of our income, our net income, not even the gross income, our net income. Whatever you earn in a year, deduct your cost of living expenses, deduct the debts that you owe to people, deduct the fees and taxes that you pay, whatever is left, pay zakah out of it. 2.5% of it, give out by way of zakah. What about the hajj? Once in a lifetime, if you can afford it. It's not obligatory if you cannot afford it. My dear brothers in Islam, what about fasting in the month of Ramadan? Again, out of 12 months in a year, Allah says, spend 1 month with me by being close to me. Just 1 month. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked us to do. They are very minor stuff. Allah will not place a burden upon us beyond our capacity. Therefore, let's try as much as possible to be ready at any time to pay our zakah. Ask the question, is it time for me to pay zakah? And what is my income? Then take a stock and go ahead and discharge this duty so that your life will be simple. My dear brothers and sisters, make life simple for yourself. Make life simple for yourself in this world and in the akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us make our life simple for ourselves. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as I stated, let's consider an example of a person who, after all deductions, let's say, for example, somebody earns $50,000 in a year. And after all deductions, he has $5,000 balance. The zakah of $5,000, 2.5% of $5,000 is just $125, which is less than $4 a day that we waste away on either ice cream or coffee or smoking or doing other stuff that are not beneficial. Less than $4 a day. For people in Nigeria, for example, $125 as at the rate of 375 naira to a dollar, is just about 46,000. For somebody who earns, you know, $5,000 in Nigeria, that's about 1,875,000. So if you remove 46,000 and give to somebody who is poor, you still have 1,830,000. It doesn't make you poor, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. Therefore, let's be willing to discharge this responsibility. And when you do so, watch out for your life in the next year and beyond. Your life will become simpler and contented. Your life will become tranquil. Your life will become better. And in the Akhirah, you'll be among those who will sit in Jannah. May Allah make that possible for us. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it's as simple as that. But let us look at those who are qualified to receive zakat. As we have stated, the 8 categories of people who are qualified to receive zakat have been listed. Therefore, it's up to us to look out for these categories of people so that we can discharge our duties towards them. And what is a recipient of zakat supposed to do? It's a recipient of zakat, when he receives zakat, he's supposed to tell the person who has given him zakat, thank you. At least, jazakallahu khairan, may Allah reward you. Or may Allah bless what you have given and what you have kept. That's a very powerful dua that the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wasalam, has taught to us. But even if you cannot recite the dua, just tell the person, thank you. Jazakallahu khair. Thank you very much, and may Allah reward you. A very simple dua. Because Allah told the Holy Prophet Muhammad, as soon as you collect their zakah, then pray for them. As soon as you collect zakah from them, pray for them, because your prayer will constitute sakan for them. What is sakan? Tranquility, contentment, happiness, success. My dear brothers and sisters, Islam, that you cannot get more than that, the life we live now. All of us are looking for contentment. We are looking for happiness. We are looking for, you know, success. May Allah grant it to us. So this is what we gain when we give out zakat to those who are entitled to zakat. But there are many other considerations that are involved that you need to watch out for so that you are in a position to discharge this responsibility in the best manner. One of the issues that we want to discuss is the issue of non-Muslim. Can we give zakat to non-Muslim? Zakat is not meant for non-Muslims. It's meant for Muslims. And the only condition under which we may give to a non-Muslim is if his heart is to be reconciled. In other words, we want to use zakat to attract that person into Islam. On such a condition, we may give zakat to a non-Muslim. But zakat is not meant for atheists and those who associate partnership with Allah. But under the condition of we can give zakat to those who are at the moment at the verge of, you know, either entry Islam or they have already entered. We want to prevent them from backsliding. Then we can give zakat to them. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, what about the issue of paying zakat by yourself or giving to somebody to pay for you? There are certain institutions that have been established to collect zakat, like the various masajid or other organizations. Yes, as I stated previously, it's better for you to pay zakat by yourself than to give it to somebody to pay for you. But if you are not in a position to be able to identify those who are entitled, then it is allowed to give to an institution to distribute for you. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I want to add at this juncture that zakat is meant for individuals, for people, not for institutions. That's why many scholars are saying that you don't give zakat to build even a masjid. Zakat is meant for individuals, for the benefit of those who are struggling in life. Look at the categories of people that Allah listed: the poor, the needy, those who distribute, those who are stranded, those who are overwhelmed by their debt, those who are in bondage. These are human beings, they are not institutions. But institutions are allowed to collect and help to distribute to them. That's the role institutions like a masjid is supposed to play. And those who are collecting, therefore, maybe pay their wages from the zakat that they have collected. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, another point that we need to clarify is the issue of whether or not you give zakat to your parents. No, your parents are under your direct responsibility. Therefore, anybody who is dependent upon you, your parents, your children, your wife, they are not entitled to zakat. The only condition on which your wife can get zakat is if she is indebted to a level where she becomes a person who qualifies as, you know, a person overwhelmed by debts. Therefore, the husband could give her money to pay off those debts. That is a condition. But can a wife give zakat to a husband? Yes, it's possible. If your husband is poor and qualified as those who can receive zakat, yes, it's possible for a wife who is well off to help her husband with zakat. But as for other relations like brothers and sisters and so on, you can give zakat to them if they qualify under the qualification of poverty or needy. Otherwise, they are not qualified to receive zakat. My dear brothers and sisters, while you are giving zakat to somebody, is it important for you to tell that person, hey, here is my zakat, I'm just giving you my zakat for this year? Well, yes, if you are not doing so ostentatiously or to ridicule that person, it's permissible. And that's why what Allah says, into budun swadaka fanimahi, wa into fuha wa tutu halifukara fuwa khairun lakum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you do your sadaqah, give out your sadaqah in the open publicly or announce it, it's okay. But if you do it in such a way that it is secret and you make sure you target the poor for it, that is better for you. In the hadith narrated by Abu Huraira, the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam says, among the seven people that will be housed under the shade of Allah on the day of accountability is the one who gives out zakah with the right hand and the left hand does not know about it. In other words, secrecy is very important. We need to learn to, you know, maintain the privacy of other people. That's what it means. And Deborah says in Islam, so when you give out zakah, if you like, you can inform the one to whom you are giving zakah, and there's nothing wrong about that. But to go on television or public media and say, you know what, this is how I distributed my zakah to these people, that is being ostentatious. We ask Allah to forgive our sin. The next one is for us to make sure that we pay zakah in our area of residence. It's more rewarding to pay your zakah in the area where you reside, unless there are no recipients in that area, as listed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or alternatively, by your own judgment, you realize that you have somebody far away more in need than those who are close to you. If people back home in your country, or the conditions of the people back home in your country is more severe than those in your place of residence in America, for example, then you have the right to send your zakat far away from your place of residence. But you pay where you reside is better, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. What about paying zakat to those who may abuse it, those who may use it to buy drugs or smoke marijuana or do stuff like that? You are not allowed to give zakat to encourage people to commit sin, but you are allowed to give zakat to help people to get out of sin. If you know that the zakat you are giving will help that person get out of the drug abuse and other sinfulness that he or she is doing, then, of course, there's nothing wrong in giving zakat to that person. Another issue that is connected with zakat is the issue of error. For example, you give zakat to the wrong person. You have been told the category of people that are entitled to receive zakat, but unfortunately, you go and give it to a wrong person. For example, a criminal or a sinner or a disbeliever or things like that. What is your option? My dear brothers and sisters, in that case, there are two opinions. You either repeat and pay zakat again, or you forgo what you have paid and leave it for Allah. Allah will decide for you and may be merciful upon you. Another point to note is that it's permissible for you to share your zakat to more than one or two persons in the categories that have been listed. If your zakat is handsome enough to go around more than one person or more than one category of the people that have been listed, then of course, why not? It's allowed for you to share your zakat between more than one person. Then, of course, it's also important for us to take note of the graciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you are qualified to pay zakat and you suddenly realize that as a result of increased responsibility, maybe you have just gotten a new baby or you have just lost a job or something else that has impacted your life and makes you more in need of the zakat than somebody else, of course, it's permissible for you not to pay zakat. Instead, you spend the money on yourself. See the mercy of Allah. It's unlimited. We ask Allah to show us his mercy. My dear brothers in Islam, can we use zakat to pay our debts? For example, somebody is owing you. Instead of giving zakat back to that person, you tell the person, you know what, the debt you are owing me, I think I forgo it for you because I now regard that debt in lieu of my zakat. That is tolerable. It's acceptable. But the zakat you give to somebody already, do not go around and tell that person to give you the zakat to pay the debt that he is owing you. That is taking back your zakat after you have paid it. My dear brothers and sisters, let us try as much as possible to do what is right. And those who are capable, who are fit, and are strong enough to walk are not entitled to receive Zakah. Instead, we should encourage them to go and work so that they can earn sufficient income. There are many issues relating to paying Zakah and receiving Zakah, my dear brothers and sisters. I may not be able to go the whole hog from this perspective. Therefore, I encourage you to find out from the imam in your area what are the limits set for us when it comes to the payment of Zakah. Make sure you do that so that you can discharge this duty in the best manner. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us what we have done, take shaitan away from our lives, and take our life far away from the shaitan. Inshallah, by the next presentation, we shall be coming to you to some of the frequently asked questions about Zakah. That may be the last topic we are going to discuss under this issue. My dear brothers and sisters, share these videos on Zakah with your friends and well-wishers so that all of us will do what is right. Then we can, you know, be rest assured, inshallah, that we meet ourselves in Jannah. Do not be selfish with the knowledge of Islam. It is our duty to spread out this knowledge. There are people who do not know what to do about Zakah. That's why they are not paying the Zakah. It's not as if they just want to evade the Zakah. But if you are among those who want to evade Zakah, I warn you, just as I warn myself, I would not like to evade Zakah. Therefore, I must continue to remind myself about it. You should not evade Zakah. Try as much as possible to pay. When you do so, you are putting a smile in somebody's face. You are earning the reward of Allah. And you are making your life simple for yourself. And you are making your life happy for yourself. May Allah make our lives happy. Take shaitan away from our lives and take our life far away from the shaitan. Rabbana tabamina innaka anta samiun alim wa tub alayna ya maulana innaka anta al-ghafurur karim. Subhana Allahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Alhamdulillah.